So Claire and Dylan, welcome. We are absolutely honoured and delighted that you are joining us this evening from London. You are in London, aren't you?
Yes, we're in London. It's so good to be here. Thanks for having us.
Hello.
It's very exciting.
Great. And ladies and gentlemen, I believe you've all got a programme. And just to say that the running order is as follows. I believe that's only one slight change. So we're going to start with the handle, given that music is all about pleasure and hopefully endless pleasure is what we will have this evening. Then we will have Purcell. And then we are going to have Mozart. And then Donizetti, and then the rest of the program as you see it. Okay. Right. Okay. So, first of all, we all love opera, I hope, and. What I would like to do is just to start with a quote by George Bernard Shaw, who defines opera as when a tenor wants to make love to a soprano and is prevented from doing so by a baritone. So shortly, you're going to hear an aria by Handel, Endless Pleasure, from the opera Semele, which Handel liked to call the story of Semele. Those were his own words. And it's considered to be in the manner of an oratorio, except that the text for this is not sacred. It is a secular text by William Congreve, in fact. And it was rather shocking at the time because it talks of an adulterous sexual relationship. And the story, just briefly, is taken from Ovid's Metamorphose. And Ovid is a Roman poet, and lots of his operas have been set to, his text has been set to opera. So for example, Mozart's Così fan tutti. Right, so in this aria, which ends Act One, Semele sings of her joy at being the god's new mistress. Over to you, Claire.
Oh,
You can't hear, but everyone is clapping. That's excellent. What a start to a program. Endless pleasure. We love it. Have you performed the role, Claire?
No, I haven't. It's one on the list that I'd like to do. So it's a great role. Really great.
Yes. And you were actually down to perform some some Handel at Glyndebourne.
I was covering, in Malcina at Glyndebourne this summer, but obviously with COVID, it all got cancelled. So unfortunately, that didn't happen.
Never mind. No.
You know.
Well, we're all dying to get back into the Opera House and, you know, to be able to come and see you and support you. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we're great that we can do things like this in the meantime.
Yeah, it's amazing. Really good. It's really great. Make music again. Brilliant.
It is. It's wonderful. So it's lovely. And of course, everyone's comfortable in their own homes. You don't have to get on the tube to traipse to the Opera House.
Mm-hmm.
Super. So we're just going to go on now. So a little bit from me, which is a little bit earlier than Handel, is Henry Purcell. And Henry Purcell was hailed as the Orpheus Britannicus because he established English serious opera and he could charm all living things. So this opera, Dido and Aeneas, has a libretto by the Irish Nahum Tate, and it was performed by the young ladies of Josias Priest's School, which is where St. Paul's stands now. And it's thought that the performance took place outside in the woodyard. Now, this opera only lasts 56 minutes, so it's really short. There's no spoken dialogue, but Dido and Aeneas is full of glorious tunes. We've got sailors carouseling, we've got witches, and we've got, of course, the famous Dido's Lament, which is terribly sad. I hope we're not going to make everybody cry this evening, Claire.
No.
And after Dido's Lament, there's a glorious choral elegy with Drooping Wings, which is really exquisite writing. And what Purcell is doing, let me tell you, he twists our emotions with this aria. He seduces us, and he knows his game plan. He very carefully, he was quite a revolutionary for his time. And this opera is greatly influenced by Italian opera and French opera. And that's evident in the dialogue that's in the opera, the recitative, and also in the dance music. We have lots of dotted rhythms, and that's really, really very, very French indeed. So all that is in Purcell's Dido and Aeneas. Now, enough from me. We've got the recitative and the aria. Over to you, Claire. Thank you.
Let me rest, more I
Absolutely beautiful. Claire, can I ask, do you have a favourite singer whom you like listening to singing that?
Yes, I heard Christina Rice singing it and it's absolutely gorgeous. Also Emma Kirkby singing it is iconic in many ways as well, I think, yeah.
Well, that's lovely. I mean, it's just an iconic piece of music, isn't it? I can't help but think of Janet Baker, who...
Oh, yes, of course, how could I forget that one? Yeah, Glyburn, that was amazing, yes. Yeah,
the 1966 production that was just absolutely spellbinding. But anyway, thank you very much. Have you, I mean, is this a role that's on your bucket list?
Sure. I mean, of course, it's an incredible role, but I'm not sure whether it's like in my far. I don't know, but I'd love to. Obviously, it's a great role and it's beautiful music. So, why not?
Would you be so kind? Would you explain to our lovely audience what Fach is?
Okay. All right. So you've got obviously the soprano, mezzo, tenor, and bass baritone. And within those voice types, you also have like in soprano, you have like a soubrette, a light lyric, coloratura, different types of sopranos within your soprano Fach. So I would say that I'm a light lyric soubrette kind of. So I would sing more, I would not sing Countess, but I would sing like Susanna. So that kind of thing. So like lighter roles. So it's, yeah.
That's the Marriage of Figaro.
Yes, that's the one.
Yeah, super. And of course, the opera houses like to pigeonhole singers. And so, you know, you are in a certain Fach when you join them. Mm-hmm. Jolly good. Okay, right. Well, now we're going to move on. No concert would be complete without some Mozart. And here we have Idomeneo, the king of Crete. And the opera in its full title is Idomeneo, King of Crete, or Ilia ed Idamante. And the role of Ilia, which Claire is going to sing tonight, her brother is Idamante, brother and sister. And it is a serious opera. Opera seria. It's very noble. And it's considered to be Mozart's first mature opera, 1871. And interestingly, after its initial success at the premiere, Mozart did not get any reviews whatsoever, but what sold it to the general public were the lavish sets. The set design was apparently out of this world. So, and that was in Munich. And Idomeneo is full of glorious arias for Elettra, the other soprano role, and Ilia, as I mentioned. So Padre Germani comes in Act One. And is there anything you want to say about it, Claire, before you begin?
It's a really interesting aria because she's saying that on one hand, she knows she's really sad about not seeing her father and worried about seeing her father and her brothers again. But I love the enemy. So it's kind of like this really interesting kind of, she goes through all the emotions within this aria. There's a lot kind of stuffed in.
There is a lot, isn't there? As most arias have that, don't they? And do we have the recitative?
Yes, a little bit.
A little bit of recit. Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Over to you.
Oh,
Thank you, Claire. Thank you. We are all clapping. Everyone's clapping.
Yay! Yeah.
Exactly. It's a super aria, and I mean, all of Ilya's music is just beautiful, isn't it? Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, so well done. Well done. Let me just pause. I'm just going to pause. Resume. We are going to stay with Italian opera, and we have work now by a 19th century Italian composer, and that's Donizetti. And this is from his famous L'Elisir d'Amore, the Elixir of Love. And he composed this in just 6 weeks in 1832. And it is a comedy. It's of the opera buffa tradition. And just a little bit of background. Dina, whom Claire is singing tonight, is in love with Nemorino, the hero, the tenor. He has got his papers to say that he's enlisted in the army, but he doesn't really want to go. And Adina realizes that she loves him, doesn't want him to go, and she says, look, why don't you stay at home? Everybody loves you, and I'll look after you. And the baritone, Belcore, wants to marry you. So I think Bernard Shaw was right in the way he was describing opera at the beginning. Also, we have the very famous Una Furtiva Lagrima, which Claire won't be singing tonight because that belongs to a tenor. Dylan, are you going to sing it for us?
No, you wouldn't want that, sorry.
Okay. And L'Elisir d'Amore is actually ranked number 13 in the lineup of the most performed operas in the world. And also, this has a very personal story to Donizetti, because he was enlisted to go and fight in the Austrian army, and he was saved from doing so by a very rich lady. And unfortunately, Donizetti's brother, Giuseppe, had to go to the army and fight. But there we go. So this is Prendi. Claire, is there anything you'd like to add to Prendi before we begin?
No, I think you've covered it all there. Really, that's great. No.
Okay, lovely. Okay, over to you.
Oh!
Thank you, Claire. That's super, absolutely super. And a beautiful role for you, I think.
Oh, great.
Yes.
Yeah, I did it down in Iford last year.
Iford Arts, yes.
Which was an amazing experience, yeah.
We're getting some claps from the audience on the screen. I should perhaps let all our audience members know, yes, thank you, there are more coming in, that you can actually, at the bottom of your screen, there's something called a reaction, and you can, we've got thumbs up reactions. Yes, lots of claps. No one's putting any ice creams up there. That's good. And, even a heart. So, yes, I hope you can see that, Claire.
Yeah.
It's amazing what technology can do, isn't it?
Amazing, yeah.
And I expect our guest who's in Paris can see if there's anybody that's connected with the Paris Opera and if they would like to hire Claire to get in touch.
Yes, please.
Super. Okay, lovely. Right. Well, we are now going to go on to something very romantic. And this is Puccini, one of his most famous Italian arias. And you might recognize this if you've seen the film A Room with a View. And interestingly, the opera received its premiere after the First World War at the Metropolitan Opera in New York. And I'm just going to tell you a little bit of the background, that the opera forms the third of Il Trittico, which is the triptych, and the other two operas are Il Tabarro, that means the cloak, and Suor Angelica, which is Sister Angelica, and that's an all-female cast, by the way. And this one, this opera, is Gianni Schicchi. And all of them, they're just one act long, but Gianni Schicchi is the favorite of the three. And Loretta is the daughter of Schicchi, and she's in love with Rinuccio, but her father doesn't want her to marry Rinuccio, and you threaten to throw yourself into the river Arno, don't you?
Yes. I don't get my way.
You're not near a river, I hope.
No. No.
Good.
Thames.
The Thames, yes. You don't want to jump in there. Yes, so this opera, it's got, you know, it's lyrical, it involves lots of jealous feuds, hypocrisy, double dealing, and it's set in medieval Florence. And this aria, it's only 32 bars long, it's really exquisite, and it's often performed as an encore at concerts. And talking about, you know, the absurdity with some operas, Gianni Schicchi opens the on stage with a corpse lying there. And W.H. Auden, who I'm a huge fan of, said, "No good opera plot can be sensible. People do not sing when they are feeling sensible." So, Claire, over to you for the lovely Babbino Caro. Thank you.
Oh,
Superb. Lots of hands in the air for that, Claire. Absolutely superb. Well done. Beautiful. It's so short. It's all... Can you sing it again? it's really divine. I'm going to ask you, have you sung Loretta anywhere?
Yeah, I did. I did it when I was at Guildhall in my second year of opera school. Before I went to Glyndebourne, we did it with the Barbican with colleagues in my year. And Chris Purves was doing the Jenny Skeeky. And it was amazing with the LSSO orchestra. And it was amazing. It was such a good experience. And to work with Chris as well, who was really amazing.
That's, yes, Christopher Purves, of course, is, I mean, he's almost a resident singer at Glyndebourne. He does a lot, doesn't he? Yeah, no, that's absolutely fabulous. It's just such glorious music. Again, it suits you to a T. It's
great because you just literally come on and sing this and that's it. And you get the biggest cheer, yeah?
That's right. Well, yes, so you should. And we're all cheering it at home for you. And what I'd just like to say, I mean, it would be great if anybody, has anyone actually been, you know, had this quality singing, a live concert during lockdown? I mean, since March, I haven't seen anything. I haven't been it, no. So people are shaking their heads saying no. You know, it's just absolutely fabulous that you're able to do this. And the quality is great. Yeah, so we've got threads in the chat box saying, no, not at all, you know. And just a couple of things to our audience members. Yeah, it's been really fab. Thank you. If you click on the box where Claire and Dylan are, you can actually pin the video. It might be big on your screen anyway, but if you just wanted to see them, then you could just have them on your main screen. So that's an option for you. Okay, great. Well, we have got another aria for you. And but this one, Claire, you've got to be wearing trousers.
I know, not dressed appropriately.
you can't exactly go and do a costume change now, can you?
No, afraid not.
No, because the role of Oscar is actually a page boy. So it's a compliment that you don't look like a boy. But so this was written. Un ballo in mascara, a masked ball, perhaps the only safe opera to put on during COVID. I don't know. That was a silly joke. what's fascinating about it is based on a true story, and it concerns King Gustav III of Sweden, who actually was assassinated. And it was as a result of some political conspiracy while he was attending a masked ball. So he died 13 days after he was shot. And this is the basis of the story of Un ballo in mascara. So the setting is in a ballroom, splendidly illuminated, and everyone is prepared for the festivities. And Oscar refuses to tell Renato. He's asking you lots. Of, he's saying, now, who is in disguise? He wants to find out about Ricardo's disguise. And you're saying, I'm not going to tell you, but I know you want to know. So you're really taunting him, I think. Is that right, Claire?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, 100%.
And after this aria, you reveal Ricardo's identity, that he's wearing a black cloak and a red ribbon. And this aria, it's remarkable because it's got great variety. It's vivid and it's got lots of varying emotions. I hope you enjoy Saper Vorresti. And you've all got your translations as well. So you can follow those if you prefer, or just watch Claire. Thank you. Absolutely sensational. Well, I'm giving you a red heart there. And that was, for our musicians amongst us, that was a top D, which not many sopranos can do that. So Claire, you're onto a winner there. And Dylan, wonderful playing as well.
Thank you, thanks very much.
Great. So, I believe that you might have a little something else up your sleeve, but before we get to that, if that's still okay, I thought I would just invite maybe one or two of the audience to, if they've got anything they would like to ask you. Perhaps you'd like to unmute yourself. I think they're being very shy.
That's all right.
Does anyone?
Encore, if you'd like.
You have to unmute yourself.
I've got a question.
Okay. Kate.
Yes, could I ask Claire, can she hear me?
Yes, I can hear you, hello. Right.
Yes, I'm just fascinated in your program. How do you put a program together? What sorts of things do you have to think about? Is it just things you love, or do you try to put some songs in that cause you some problems or that you want to work on, or is there a kind of a formula? I'm just fascinated.
Well, me and Helen talked about the program, and we kind of started early to go later from like Handel to Verdi.
Yes.
But also it's always good to kind of challenge yourself and to push yourself, because otherwise you're never going to get any better. So it's always good to kind of put something in that's a bit scary or a bit like new. I always think that's always quite good, really.
Yeah. Oh, interesting. And can I also ask, roughly how long does this take to put together this kind of program? Is this about a year's work or 6 months' work? Or
it depends, really. So we have like as singers, we have audition packages. So like arias that are always good to go. Different houses or different size of houses, so you've always got to kind of have this kind of amount of arias kind of always on, working really. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. And what Claire means by that is different sized opera houses. Yes. Yeah, that's right. No, that's lovely. And we've got one question in the thread here, Claire, that someone's asking, what's your favourite duet?
Duet? Oh my goodness. Oh gosh.
Do you have one?
In L'Elysée, the duet with, this is a bit with Dulcamara, when she realizes that the potion is just wine. That's quite fun, and it's quite an interesting kind of duet. I like that one.
Lovely, thank you. Okay, any other questions from our audience?
Yes, I have a question for Dylan, if I could.
Hello.
Hello, Dylan, can I ask you, how do you have to alter your technique in order to accompany rather than playing solo?
That's a good question, Patrick, thank you. Well, I started playing solo music, and I studied playing solo music until I was about 20, and then I started studying accompaniment. And really the main thing is always having open ears and listening to your partner and making sure that what they're doing is what they want to do, and guiding them through the music in a good way. So it's not much to do technically differently, but it's more about being a bit more aware of your surroundings than if you're just in your head for solo music.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you. Faye, would you like to ask a question?
Yes, please. My favourite duet has got to be from the Pearl Fishers, which is for tenor and bass, but which obviously you can't sing. But my question was around the Dido. I'm learning that at the moment with Helen, and I was just wondering what tips you would give in terms of the positives and the negatives, especially getting to the high notes.
So a tip that Dylan gave me is keep it moving. Don't get slower and slower. It's very easy to just kind of get stuck and keep it. So keep it going. With regards to the high note, I always believe that it's the preparation of the note before the high note that's the most important. So you've got to really prepare that from the D to the G, you have to really prepare that D and make it spin and live so that you can get to the G. That's how I would do it. Hope that helps.
Absolutely right. Great. Well, we've got time for another one or two, if anybody would like to take the opportunity.
It's Jill. I'd like to ask Claire how much her costume affects how she prepares and how she performs a role. Does it help or hinder?
It depends what the costume is. Really, I did Oscar last year at Opera Holland Park as a young artist, and obviously wearing trousers. And but she was quite Oscar was quite androgynous in many ways. The director wanted to be quite like feminine as well, so it's kind of quite tricky. But as soon as you kind of put on like a pair of trousers and you pretend to be a boy, it's really great fun. And really, it's just, you know, it's something very different, and it's definitely not you that is you're singing it, but you're not. It's not you. It's a character. But yeah, when I did Adina, I was wearing dungarees last year, and I loved that because she was quite earthy and quite, you know, got down and dirty on her orange. Grove where it was set anyway. So so costume definitely helps. Sometimes it can be really hard, like I did Saul at Glyndebourne, and their costumes are absolutely enormous and really heavy, and the stage is on a rake, and there was definitely one bit where we have to roll backwards up the rake really, really slowly, and you know, we'd had like all our big dresses kind of falling over our head, and you know, you're showing your pants, and you know, so there's definitely lots to work with costume. Yeah.
Thank you,
Claire. Thank you. One other quick question before we have our finale. It's absolutely delightful that we, you know, that the audience have this opportunity to speak to you. Is anybody else that would like to say anything? I feel like I'm an auctioneer, going, gone. Okay. All right. Well, that's enough from me. Claire, I think we would all absolutely cherish an encore if you would be so inclined.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, definitely. We've prepared Somewhere Over the Rainbow, I feel like it's quite an interesting piece to sing at this time of our lives. I know it's been quite iconic within the lockdown and the pandemic. So we'd like to finish with Somewhere Over the Rainbow.
Beautiful. Absolutely fantastic. And Dylan, thank you. I think you both, yes. Come on, let's give you a big round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's been a real honor hosting this first event. So terrific. Did you enjoy yourselves?
Yes,
yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
It's been what a treat to be able to make music again. So
yes. Well, hopefully you'll come back and give us another one at a later date.
That'd be lovely.
I do have another soprano lined up for our October concert, Catherine Crompton, who's absolutely superb as well. So I hope you can join us for that. We've got a whole series of really talented singers lined up right up till Christmas. So, and I will be sending a little email to all you, our lovely audience members, for some feedback on this evening. Just honestly, I mean, Claire and Dylan, what a treat for tonight. I think it's been the highlight of our week. Listening to you live tonight. Yes. So We're all clapping again, and just thank you from the bottom of our hearts for performing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Helen, for organising everything.
Thank you, Helen.
An absolute pleasure. Absolute pleasure. And fantastic performance, beautiful. Thank you, Claire, Dylan, and Helen, coming in.
Thank you.
So I will be closing the session and just wish you all a lovely evening and look forward to seeing you again soon.
Yes. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.